I mean, we have to put it in context. When you take a look at China, it's been aggressively investing in Indonesia. And then we have on the other side, the US, which is a very important strategic partner. How will this play out? And what's the risk on Indonesia's economy?
Well, I think if the trade war happened between US and China, the impact will be very bad, not only for Indonesia, for Southeast Asian market as well. The impact may come on the financial sector through bonds, through stocks, but the most important one also will have an impact on the future China growth, which is later on will be translated into Southeast Asian countries, including Indonesia, because China is one of the most important and the largest trading partner for ASEAN countries, including Indonesia. So I can imagine if China slow down because this trade war, and it will have an impact on our export, and then later on will be translated into slowdown of our GDP growth.
Do you see a possible scenario where Indonesia would have to take sides, one or the other?
I don't think this, you know, in this particular game, that taking side will be an useful or, you know, a wise way to solve the problem. Because I think there is no single country in the world can act individually to solve this problem. So I do believe that probably discussion in the WTO, the G20, I think will be very important to solve this problem.
You talked about how it can impact Indonesia's growth. Currently growing at 5.5%, a long way off from the president's target of 7%. Why so sluggish, and what will it take?
The first one is also the impact of this collapse of commodity prices, you know, still have an impact on Indonesian economy. The second one is because this infrastructure project will take some time before they can promote growth. At the same time, the share of manufacturing sector in Indonesian economy is still relatively less compared to natural resources and, you know, the energy. So to me, 5% is okay, but if you're talking about in the future, we need to grow by 6 to 7. Otherwise, there is a risk for Indonesia for growing old without becoming rich.
Chatib, it's Yvonne in Hong Kong. Thanks so much for joining us here on the program. What do you see the direction of Bank Indonesia then under this new leadership from Perry Warjio? I mean, he's considered more of a hawk when it comes to inflation than his predecessor. Is he the right guy to guide Indonesia at a time when we are seeing volatility come back to the markets and EM certainly facing those headwinds?
Well, I know Perry personally. He is a good central banker. He has a lot of experience with Bank Indonesia. And I think he will be the right person to, you know, to lead the Bank Indonesia, especially during this normalization of monetary policy in the US. But one thing I would like to comment on this, if the Fed raised the interest rate by 4 times this year, I think it is most likely the Bank Indonesia should raise the interest rate by 25 basis points, at least by the end of the year.
So you see a difference in policy then, now that we've seen Indonesia cut rates 8 times since early 2016, you're saying now is the time to actually start following the Fed?
Well, I think every Asian countries now, like it or not, should follow the direction in the U.S. because otherwise they cannot maintain the parity and stability for the exchange rate.
Interesting point there. It's interesting, too, we also heard from the U.S. ambassador of Indonesia, Jonathan Donovan, didn't hold up on his opinions here when it came to investment into Indonesia. He criticized the country for foregoing billions of dollars of investment and told countries who criticize U.S. protectionism to basically look in the mirror. How do you respond to that?
Well, I think we are in the situation that not very good for all over the world, because if you're talking about this protectionist issue, it's not only happened in Indonesia, but also other part of the world, which is later on will provide an ammunition for politicians. Why should I spend my political capital to liberalize the economy if other countries do the same? So I think, you know, the example of the potential trade war between U.S. and China, for example, it might create a sort of like, you know, a bad impact for Indonesia, because it will give ammunition for politicians. We said they can say that we don't need to liberalize the economy, because even the U.S. and also China will do the same to impose the protection.
Indonesia has been trying to get a lot more foreign money. And to that angle, President Jokowi has removed hundreds of regulations to attract foreign investment, but there are at least 42,000 more regulations in place hindering such investment. Has Indonesia done enough? Has it moved quickly enough to open up its economy?
Well, there are two things here, Aslinda. The first one is, I think, we have to appreciate what the government has been undertaken related to the economic deregulation. But unfortunately, most of the economic decision nowadays lies to the local government. And the central government does not have any instrument to annul the local government decision. And that's the reason why, even though President Jokowi already launched a series of economic deregulation, the impact on the foreign direct investment was not very significant. So unless we can find or create a scheme to provide a reward and penalty if the local government do not, you know, produce a good investment climate, and I'm afraid that the impact on the investment will be relatively, you know, will be relatively small.
Earlier, you talked about how the central bank will need to raise rates should the Fed continue to raise rates. Is the weak rupiah complicating everything?
I don't think so, because if you look at nowadays, most of the currency is also depreciated against U.S. dollar, and I think this is good for.
But this is one currency that's one of the worst performers in Asia.
The reason behind it is because if you look at the composition of the bondholders, 40% are foreigners. So it is very normal if there is a shock in other country, they will dump our bond and then convert into U.S. dollar. But if you look at in terms of this volatility, 13,800. I don't think this is really a big, you know, a big issue for Indonesia, as long as the volatility in the in the forex market could be more or less not saying control, but reduce the smoothing the volatility done by the central bank.
So are you saying that the weak currency is not a risk to the economy?
No, I don't think the weak currency is the risk for the economy. Yeah, because we adopted this flexible exchange rate since a couple of years ago. If you recall, even during the taper tantrum 2013, we depreciated the rupiah by 15%, and we didn't have a crisis at the time.
So if the rupiah is not a risk, what is a risk to the Indonesian economy?
To me, now, the biggest issue is more on the contingent liabilities related to the state-owned enterprise, which is very aggressive in expanding many projects on infrastructure. If something happened, then will become a burden of our budget, of our fiscal.
How about an over-reliance on Chinese money? Is there a risk to that?
I don't see that, you know.
Have you seen strings attached, for instance, to the investments?
Not much. You know, there are many news spread around regarding this, but in terms of the realization, it's still relatively small. Japanese is still the biggest investor for the country.
If you had to give a rating on how President Jokowi has performed in his during his term, what would your call be?
I would put the 7 out of 10, because it's not easy to run a country like Indonesia. He consolidated everything's, you know, political situation in a very well manner. The economy, even though grows by 5%, is not enough, but it's pretty much stable in the last couple of years. So I think he's doing quite well.
And he can be reelected?
I think so.
Based on?
He's very popular. If you look at the approval rate, you know, he's always on the top of this survey, all the political surveys.